and I believe the town's name is Washougal. I forgive me if I mispronounce that. And after the event, it was on a Sunday night, and it was about 9 o'clock, and I didn't want to stay in town because I wanted to make the show. Big mistake on my part. So I left the area in Washington, which is about 30 minutes east of Vancouver, and I headed down the I-5 corridor, and probably about when I reached Albany, it started snowing. At that point in time, it was about almost 11 o'clock, and so the snow was coming down pretty hard. I don't know if I don't know what was experienced here on the coast, but I've never seen it snow that hard in Oregon. You know, I'm from places where I've seen a lot of snowfall in my time, but nothing like that have I ever seen here in Oregon, except on the east side of the state. So it was coming down really hard. I mean, it was really covering the roads. And this, like I said, this was Sunday night last week. And I got up to the point where I was at the turnoff for 38, and I took that turnoff, and I made it all to the point where, you know, you're heading up into the hills, and trees were hanging over the road. And this is about midnight at that point in time, and trees were hanging over the road. They were snow packed, and as you're driving, you're going right under these trees that are hanging over you. And I finally got to Drain, Oregon, which is a little bitty town, and I went right past it, about 100 yards going up the street to the out of Drain, heading west. And as you go up that hill towards the bridge, well, when I got to the top of that hill, there was a tree blocking my way. And I stopped to see if I could get out. And at that point, there was a couple of inches already on the ground, and my car was already having trouble getting through. And so two gentlemen came down out of the house and said, "Hey, you're not going to be able to make it. This road is closed. The tree came down." And of course, well, I could see that. And I said, "Well, can't we get some chainsaws or something and cut this out of here?" And they said, "Well, cutting a tree down is no problem. It's the car underneath it." Now, the tree was so big that I couldn't even see the car. So at this point in time, like, it's about 1 in the morning, and there was about 6 cars who now have gathered up on the hill, and we're all stuck. And we all had to turn around and go back to Drain, and I got stuck in the Chevron that night, Sunday, from about 1 in the morning, and I stayed there until about 8 the next morning, when there was a few more people around, and I had to dig myself out. And I went and asked the sheriff, "Well, how do I get out of here now that I'm unstuck?" And he says, "Well, get back in your car and have a good time, because you're not getting out of here. There's all the roads out of Drain were closed." So I couldn't even get out of Drain, even though I was, you know, finally got my car stuck from out of being in the snow. So it was quite an experience, and which was unique because it was my birthday last week. So I got to spend the birthday, my 53rd birthday, sitting in the car listening to the trees crack around me. And let me tell you, I want to give a huge recognition to the people of Drain, because they came out, and it was like fun time for all them. It was a beautiful snow day, because about 2 in the morning, the whole town started coming out. The kids were out in their four-wheel drives. They had their doom buggies flying around. There was a couple of guys in their snowmobiles. And of course, I'm stuck there in my little Sentra at the gas station thinking, man, these people are incredible. And so I want to give kudos to the town of Drain, because it was not only did they have a snow and were they trapped in, but it was an entire blackout. So there was a couple of people who didn't have gas, and they couldn't get gas because they had no electricity. So it was a complete blackout for the town. And when they did finally open up the roads, it was about 3 o'clock, and I was able to make it from Drain over to Sutherland. And I got onto the I-5 where they had finally opened up Rice Hill. And when I hit Roseburg, half the town there was blacked out as well. So it was quite an experience, and I have to give kudos to all those people who live up in those mountain towns, because you're very rugged individualists, and I'm very impressed that you guys have the ability to live up there in that kind of conditions and make the best of it. And so that's what happened to me last week. And I called the station, and they offered me Friday, and I said, heck yeah. I'd like to end out the week with a show, because I've got a really good show for you. And when I was at the event in Washington, Joey Gibson from Patriot Prayer, we were talking, and I told him that I wanted to have him on the show because there's been some things going on up in Portland that I thought the people of Coos County might want to hear about. And when I get back from this commercial break, we're going to go to Joey. We got him on the lines. And we're going to talk about Patriot Prayer. We're going to talk about how he started in this movement that he's in and basically where we're going to go with that. So when we're through with all that, you're gonna be very impressed with this young man, because I think he's someone who I think a lot of people out there would like to have their children emulate, because he is someone who I think is a good character, and I think he's doing a wonderful thing. And so when we get back from our commercials, we'll talk to him. So we'll see you after the break.
Hi, Danny here at Far West Tire and Auto. Do you feel like you're constantly on the go? From daily commuting, dance recitals, and weekend adventures? I'm sure your tires have never let you down, but that much time on the road can cause some wear and tear on your tires. It might be time to consider upgrading to Nokians. With the 50,000-mile warranty on select Nokians, you can hit the road in style. So stop on by Far West Tire and Auto on Highway 101 Coos Bay. Always the right tire, always the right price.
Stop in today to the all-new one-stop gun shop, Hole-in-the-Wall Gun Shop in Coos Bay. Your area leader in quality firearms, Hole-in-the-Wall Gun Shop proudly features the top brands of new and used handguns, hunting rifles, black rifles, antique and collectible guns, ammo, mace, and more. Gun cleaning and repair, expert advice, and handgun safety classes for concealed carry permits are offered too. So stop into Hole-in-the-Wall Gun Shop across from Cumyon's on Highway 101 South in Coos Bay. We buy, sell, or trade.
The RV business is booming at the Boomin' Y, and Gibbs RV is looking for nice pre-owned RVs to consign or buy. Gibbs RV makes it so simple. They will come to your location, give you a fair appraisal, and help take care of all the paperwork. It doesn't get any easier than that. So let the professionals at Gibbs RV take the hassle out of selling or consigning your RV. Stop by and see them today at 1845 Ocean Boulevard in Coos Bay by the Big Boomin' Y in Empire, or check them out at GibbsRV.com.
We're back in session. It's the Rob Taylor Report. And here he is, Rob Taylor.
Hey, everybody. It's Rob Taylor, and thank you for joining me again. As I was telling you, last weekend we had a heck of an event up in Washougal, Washington, where we were with Patriot Prayer Group and Joey Gibson. And me and Joey and his group, we've been traveling around Washington, or I've been to a couple of the events. He's done quite a few more than I've been to. I've only been to about three or four of these events. And what we've been trying to do is we've been trying to get the cities and the counties to pass Second Amendment sanctuary ordinances, because they have passed some pretty overbearing gun laws in Washington, just like they're getting ready to do here in Salem. But one of the things they did in Washington, they passed an initiative, 1639, and it was passed in a very dubious way. And so Joey took the moniker up on that and started challenging this new law in Washington. So I was thrilled with it. I'm glad to be working with him on this issue. But I wanted him to come on the show to tell us exactly how he got involved with Patriot Prayer and how he started with all this, because I think it's a very interesting story. And anyone who's out there who wants to become an activist, and this goes back to political therapy. That's, you know, that's what I always talk about, is that part of having political therapy is getting over the loss and the grief of losing on political grounds and losing more of your authority to the government. Well, there's a way to fight back, and that fighting back is part of that political therapy as becoming an activist who's involved. And the only way that I thought that we could to make sure that people are understanding that they have their own destiny in their hands is to have people like Joey Gibson on my radio show, who is an activist, who didn't wait for anyone else to tell him what to do or how to do it. He just did it all on his own. And so I wanted to have those types of experiences on my radio show, because I know there's a lot of people out there who are tired of watching the government just grow and grow and grow and get more involved in our life on every level. So that's why I had Joey Gibson on the show. And right now, that's where I'm going. Joey, are you on the line?
I sure am.
Hey, how'd you like my intro? Was that okay, man?
That was beautiful. Thank you.
All right. So, Joey, you've been doing this for a while, and you've been making a lot of news. Tell us how you first got involved with all this.
So I first got involved because I'm sitting at home, I'm sitting on the couch, and I'm watching TV like a lot of Americans during the 2016 election, and I see people leaving a Trump rally in San Jose, and they're getting beat up in the streets in front of the police, and no one's intervening, no one's protecting them. And that moved me so much that I just decided that I'm going to start to challenge this because, I made this assumption at the time, and I was correct that the mayors were having the police stand down. And they're doing this so that citizens will come in, because apparently all Trump supporters are racist. That's the lie they're building at the time.
Right.
So all these citizens would come in and chase people out of town, so that way people would be too afraid to stand up for freedom in California and the Bay Area.
And one of the specific spots that I know you took on was Berkeley, in the campus of Berkeley. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, I took that on. Put that on my shoulders. You saw what happened with Milo. Milo went in there, and basically they almost burned down the entire campus, and the police were sitting there watching. And of course, most police officers, they want to do their job, especially
right.
against these children who treat them like trash. It's hard for them to sit back and watch them, commit crimes. And so we went down there several times. I'm sure people remember some of the news coverage where, there's a helicopter view of just two groups just going at each other, hundreds of people just fighting in front of the police. And we finally ended that by going in there the final time, August 27th, 2017. And this is after Charlottesville. And we went in there with our hands up, three brown guys, took a beating by a bunch of white guys calling us racist in front of national television. We did it walking in front of the police lines.
Yeah.
And that outraged so many people that now, you have free speech in Berkeley. Now the police will protect you.
Now, let me ask you something. Someone who is, you're half Japanese, right? And you're a minority.
Definitely.
And you were talking about all the brown guys, the three brown guys that went in there. How did you guys feel about a bunch of Anglos calling you people racist? And I don't mean to say you people, but I mean people of a different color racist when they're standing up for the same constitutional rights that the founders have fought for, How did you feel about that?
I can't even comprehend it. I don't understand it. It's like the Twilight Zone. And on top of that, they have shields that say no hate.
Oh, yeah.
They're coming after us, yelling, screaming, cussing, spitting at us, throwing balls of piss, pepper spraying us, all at the same time. They're white guys calling us racist, and they have signs that say no hate.
Yeah, and so when I saw parts of those videos and I saw some of that, and I thought it was just absolutely, we've seen videos of people in Portland where they're blocking off roads, and you have that one big fat white guy coming up to the white driver saying, "Oh, you're a racist," and all that stuff, and I'm thinking, "Well, you're white yourself," And so I once again, they're using racism as a way to create a wedge between people like you and me who may look differently, but we have a heck of a lot of similarity in our beliefs. And I think that's part of this, don't you?
It's to take away from my message that they don't want to. Okay, so anyone like you or me or anybody who preaches freedom, it's a really easy thing to sell to people, right? You're talking about freedom. It's the most beautiful thing we have in this country.
Right.
And some of these far left cities, they forgot to think about freedom. They've forgotten it completely. So when you go in there with that message, they never attack my message. They never have any problems with anything that I say. They just simply go to racist, Nazi, fascist, the same words over and over again. It's for a lack of intelligence, a lack of argument, and it's to kind of get people to turn away from hearing the message.
So what eventually ever happened in Berkeley now?
So after we went in there and took that beating, there was national news coverage all over. All the left-leaning media disavowed Antifa, which is what we wanted to do, because Antifa, they're looking like heroes after Charlottesville.
Right.
Nancy Pelosi, who was supporting Antifa, disavowed them. The mayor of Berkeley, who has always been supporting them, disavowed them. So we wanted to challenge it, though. Here's the beautiful thing. So Milo went back into Berkeley after that. He was literally standing out in the open in the middle of campus. And there was no violence, no Antifa presence, because the police said they would do their job. Ben Shapiro went in there, no rioting at all in UC Berkeley. Patriot Prayer went to UC Berkeley at least four times after that. No riots, nothing. And so there's been several rallies there since. And so now you can go in there. Now, there's still some major problems. you have a professor at one of those small community colleges. He got arrested for taking a bike lock to a Patriot who was just innocent guy, attempted murder, took a bike lock to his head.
That was the one in the
4 days.
That was the one in the video, right? That was the one where, yeah, I saw that and I could not believe that. And there were police standing around at the time.
They didn't do anything.
They didn't do anything.
So that was before we took the beating. So that's, so the problem is it's a culturally, and the communism is a big part in Berkeley. It's a big part of the school system, especially in the community colleges. And they did this thing where they started to get students to record professors who were spewing out anti-American, communist, anti-cop kind of stuff. And when they post that, it gets millions of views, and they kick those students out of the school and call them racist. So
right.
I'm thinking about going down there and doing some events at some of these smaller community colleges that are just filled with communist professors.
That would be quite interesting. When you were talking about Milo, I can't think of the guy's last name. Can you... Monopolist.
That's, I can't pronounce it. Yeah.
Say that again, Bill.
Yannopoulos.
Okay, I knew it was something. Okay, this is a young man who's gay and who's had black boyfriends, okay? So this is so funny that... Yeah, so it was so funny that they would go in there and they would be against somebody who is so socially liberal but fiscally conservative. You know what I mean? It's like the whole world has been turned into bizarro land, you know? Like in Superman, you know, yes means no and no means... It's just crazy. So I just found that absolutely interesting that they were protesting Milo because, you know, they were trying to portray him as a racist and the guy's gay and he has black boyfriends and stuff. Come on, you know? So
I know. It's like I swear God has a sense of humor on these things because Milo is, you know, he's one of the most hated people. The left hate him. But, yeah, I mean, he loves black men. He's gay, but he's a Trump supporter. He's conservative. So,
and this
is another thing. I have a guy who I've been talking to down. He went to one of the two-year universities or small colleges down in the Bay Area. And he says what he's doing is he's getting a bunch of minorities together who are conservative. He says that these far-left violent extremists, they specifically target minorities who are conservative. Because it destroys their message. So it's almost like these guys are being racist. They're literally going after, you know, any minorities.
Right.
Or if you're gay, black, whatever, specifically because you're conservative.
Right.
So
and
it's really interesting what's going on.
I saw a young man who they had him on the news last night, and he was testifying for a conservative group. And they interviewed him afterwards, and they asked him what he has experienced. And he says, well, they call me Uncle Tom. They call me a racist. They call me, you know, all kinds. They say that I hate myself because I believe in this ideology. And yet that's really what it comes down to is that he believes in a limited government and more freedom for the people. And yet the socialist collectivists just cannot stand anyone who has the you know, opposing words to this. And I imagine you find this every day, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And the funny thing is, so what I like to do is I love to get communist or far left people. I love to get them to speak out loud on video, right? Because I want people to hear what they have to say. But they don't want us to be on video. They don't want our voices out there, which is really funny. Because I believe when we get them talking on videos, like not only do we get a lot of views because they sound really bad, it just kind of exposes them for who they are. But they don't want us to be exposed to the world. They don't want the world to hear our message of freedom.
You know, and that's something that I was glad that in our last event, and that was the one in Washougal, we had a film crew from HBO, one of their programs, they're filming us. And I don't know, they're probably left-leaning and stuff. But at least they were trying to film us and get some of what we were doing. Have you found that more people are starting to come around to wanting to hear your message?
Yes, people are definitely interested. And ironically, I have a lot of people who now support me and follow me because they originally looked into me because apparently I was some Asian white supremacist.
Right.
So, like, it was this confused guy. And so, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of people, if they do the research, they like my message. But the problem is there's a lot of people who just immediately make assumptions about me or make assumptions about Patriot Prayer. Or there's a lot of people who just make assumptions about most people in the movement right now. Like,
yeah.
They believe there's some motivation of racism when that's not it at all. In fact, we don't care. You know, people who believe in freedom, they don't care about your gender, your sexuality, your skin color. None of that matters. What matters is us first, them, the people at the top. That's it.
You know, and I couldn't agree with you more. And that's why it always gets me so, you know, I almost get so frustrated because they call me all kinds of names. And like I said, I don't care who you're sleeping with. I don't care who you're banging. I don't care what color your skin is, man. I just don't want you to make me pay for it or participate. I want you to live your life, and I want me to be able to live my life. And, you know, when I saw you out there, like I said, you know, I heard a lot of the rumors. And I, as someone who's been, you know, maligned myself in the press, I don't listen to that. I immediately want to talk directly to the source. And that's why I contacted you. So, you know, when we started talking about a lot of this stuff, you know, I was even warned. It was funny. Some of the guys from the 3%ers, well, you got to watch out for this Joey guy. You know, he's kind of wild. And I'm thinking, well, that's what they say about the 3%ers. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely. They're the 3%ers apparently are some far right extremist group who want to destroy the government. But they just, like us, they just want the government to be smaller and follow the Constitution. But I also believe too, like there is a part of me that is wild in terms of I'm willing to put a lot on the line for this country. I'm willing to do things that no one else is willing to do. But I've made mistakes, but at the end of the day, I just follow my heart. And, you know, I believe courage is the only thing that's going to take this country back.
I couldn't agree with you. And I'll tell you, Joey, I think you've got cojones of brass out there. I'm telling you, you're going into the middle of Portland and doing what you're doing. I was just so blown away by that because it's something that I haven't experienced in my area. Because anytime I go out with we're rallying for America, we're rallying for the Constitution, or we're rallying for the Second Amendment, everyone here in Coos County, except for very few, are all into it. And, you know, I get a big response down at the boardwalk or, you know, any of the tea parties that I threw. So, you know, for us, we're in a safe place. But when you're in Portland, man, that's, you're right in the devil's den, wouldn't you say?
So I've been to cities all over the country, you know, most of the major cities. And I've been in some dark cities, but Portland is the darkest city I've ever experienced in my entire life. And I think there's a reason why I live right by it. I think it was fate. There's some really dark things happening in Portland, and it's cultural. And it's really weird. It's hard for me to go in there. I don't enjoy it. But at the end of the day, you know, my courage really just comes from God and my faith, because I believe in God so much that I just believe that if it's my time, it's my time. If I'm going to get assaulted and beat up, then that's, you know, by the grace of God. And so, you know, I just keep going in there and hopefully that people can begin to wake up of what's going on in there. The beautiful thing, though, is you have a lot of people in Portland, especially business owners, who actually hate the culture in Portland, but they're too afraid to speak up.
Yeah.
I get tons of letters. I get tons of emails from people thanking me, but they're just like, don't tell me when I said that. So the message is getting out there. It's just, it's slow and it's difficult.
Yeah, I get that often. I'll go to meetings and people go, oh, hey, Rob, I really support you, but hey, please don't stand next to me at the meeting. So, yeah, I get that quite often myself. Hey, I've got to pay some of the bills, and we're going to go to a commercial break. And when we get back, I want to discuss more about your religion and more about Portland, if that's okay.
Sure.
All right, we'll be right back.
Before you choose your adventure, make sure your 4x4 is modified and ready to reach uncharted areas. Leave your cares behind and all the work to the experts at Tom and Giggs Automotive. From diesel power to towing access, the Bay Area's top 4x4 performance headquarters will help you get ready for wheeling and down the trail. Pick up all the necessities and the I've gotta have it's on the showroom floor. Get your rig adventure ready the right way with Tom and Giggs Automotive, your 4x4 performance headquarters, one block past the Boomin' Y and Empire, and online TomandGigs.com.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans. Think you can't manage the down payment it takes to purchase a new home? Think again. You could move into a $150,000 home with as little as $1,500 down with our 1% down payment option. The rate today on a 30-year fixed-rate mortgage is 3.99%, APR 4.19%. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to quickenloans.com.
Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. Licensed in all 50 states. NMLSconsumeraccess.org.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans. Every day people ask me, Jay, did I miss out? Have the rates gone up? The answer is no. Rates are still low, and it's a perfect time to refinance your home, especially if your mortgage rate is higher than 4.25%. If you'd like to lower your interest rate and save thousands of dollars in interest without starting over on a new 30-year loan, a Quicken Loans Yorgage is what you're looking for. With our exclusive Yorgage, you can choose a term that works best for you, anywhere from 8 to 30 years. The rate today on an 8-year Yorgage is 3.25%, APR 3.75%. For 7 years in a row now, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation for customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. And for the third year in a row, they've also ranked us highest in the nation for mortgage servicing. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to quickenloans.com. That's 800-QUICKEN.
For J.D. Power award information, visit jdpower.com. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. Licensed in all 50 states. NMLSconsumeraccess.org, number 3030.
Your brain is an amazing thing, but as you get older, it naturally begins to change, causing a lack of sharpness or even trouble with recall. Thankfully, the breakthrough in Prevagen helps your brain and actually improves memory. The secret is an ingredient originally discovered in jellyfish. In clinical trials, Prevagen has been shown to improve short-term memory. Prevagen, the name to remember, now available in stores everywhere. Statements have not been evaluated by the FDA. This product is not intended to treat, cure, or prevent any disease.
All right, so I have insomnia, but I've never slept better. And what's changed? Just a pillow. It's had such a positive impact on my life. And of course, I'm talking about My Pillow. I fall asleep faster, I stay asleep longer, and now you can too. Just go to MyPillow.com or call 800-919-6090. Use the promo code Hannity, and Mike Lindell, the inventor of My Pillow, has the special four-pack. Now you get 40% off two My Pillow premiums and two Go Anywhere pillows. Now My Pillow is made here in the USA, has a 60-day unconditional money-back guarantee, and a 10-year warranty. Go to MyPillow.com right now or call 800-919-6090, promo code Hannity, to get Mike Lindell's special four-pack offer. You get two MyPillow premium pillows and two Go Anywhere pillows for 40% off. And that means once those pillows arrive, you start getting the kind of peaceful and restful and comfortable and deep healing and recuperative sleep that you've been craving and you certainly deserve. MyPillow.com, promo code Hannity. You will love this pillow.
We're back in session. It's the Rob Taylor Report. And here he is, Rob Taylor.
Hey, everybody. If you're joining me, you know that we are talking to Joey Gibson from the Patriot Prayer. And one of the things that was impressive about this young man was he was a very devoutful Christian. And that is something that I think is lacking today in a lot of areas. And I think part of it is because people, especially young people, don't see it as something that's cool, that's hip. And I know the fact that I use the word hip means I'm no longer hip anymore. And so that's what I was really impressed with Joey, is that he's not afraid to wear his religion on his sleeve and he's not afraid to talk about it. And Joey, I've always wanted to ask you, where did you come to your religion?
Well, I don't like to say that I'm religious because I don't follow any specific, there's no specific church I follow, but I actually was raised Catholic. And that's where one of the things that kind of turned me away from religion from the very beginning. I know some people think religion, they think that if you're not religious, then you don't believe in God, but that's not true. I had a Sunday school teacher. I must have been in second or third grade. I remember it clear as day. And I remember she said that if you're not Catholic, that means you're going to go to hell.
Right.
I immediately knew. I don't know what it was within me. I knew it wasn't true. And that's when I kind of left religion in my heart. And I kind of followed what I believe, followed the scripture and prayed and listened for answers. And so pretty much, I go to church. I go to random churches. Like, I'll randomly be driving by and I'm like, I want to go in that church. And so, and a lot of it comes from support from other people, praying with other people, but a lot of praying and a lot of reading scripture. But I don't know, I can't even remember a time where I ever even doubted the existence of God. I think that that's just been a blessing in my life. And I think that even when I was in periods where I was making bad choices and I didn't pray for years, I knew that God was real. I just wasn't living life the right way. So I think that I'm just blessed to have that and have that in my life. And I know for a fact that I would not be able to do any of the stuff that I'm doing now. I wouldn't have the courage. I wouldn't be able to you know, it's really hard because I have a lot of people that surround me, and people cut me down every single day. And so the only thing I can really lean on in my life is Jesus, and he's helped guide me every step of the way.
Man, that's absolutely beautiful. And by the way, you're talking to a former altar boy yourself. So here I spent a lot of years in Catholicism, and then my parents decided to turn to become Episcopalians, which I always laughed because, you know, the reason the Episcopalian Church was created was because, you know, the King of England got tired of divorcing his wives and losing all the money because instead, he just decided to cut their heads off, but he left the Catholic Church so that he could go get those divorces, and that's how we got stuck with the Episcopalian Church, and I call that Catholic light. But I'm someone who, I agree with you, I think more young people would be, and probably are, a lot more religious than what the media today is credited them for, and that's because they're not in organized religion. And I think part of it is, like you said, is that, you know, when you're in church, and when you're especially in the Catholic Church, and it happens in Baptist Church and it happens in Pentecostal Church, because I've got family who's in all of them, they all become tribalistic or territorialistic with their religion, and to me, they're all praying to the same God, so the goal is the same ultimate goal. And that's why I'm glad that you're kind of stepping out and allowing people to be able to see your religious beliefs in the same way that Christ used to wander around talking about Christianity without having that organized religion, without Catholicism being around, without the church, because there were no Christians until there was a Christ, and that was Jesus the Christ. And so I love the fact that that's how you interpret that, and that's how you put it. And so congratulations. I'm, you know, that's because there's a lot of young people out there who don't have the confidence to say just exactly what you just said. Now, you put that into practice when you started going to Portland. About when did you start going to Portland and doing your Patriot prayer?
I would say that the first time was April of 2017. The first time I went to Portland, what had happened was that they're having their annual Rose City Parade or whatever, and the Multnomah County Republicans had entered the parade, and they were going to march it with Trump flags. Uh-huh. Now, Antifa had come in there and made so many threats, saying that if they don't kick the Republicans out of the parade, then they're gonna storm the parade and block it, and even I think they made some threats too. They ended up canceling the entire parade. So I organized, so no one got to enjoy the parade.
Right.
I organized a Trump march because I was like, okay, well, they're gonna cancel the whole parade, but we're still gonna do the Trump march. So we got about 150 people down there. And that was kind of the beginning of going to Portland. And my first huge rally was June of 2017, and there's probably about 1,000 people there. And so that kind of made me infamous in Portland, and I've kind of been battling with Ted Wheeler since then.
Hey, tell us exactly what it was that Nancy Pelosi said about you in the national news that you guys got into a little feud, and that's kind of really what made you, you know, really put you on the compass, you know what I'm saying? Put you on the map. And
yeah, definitely. Yeah, she called me a white supremacist, and so I had a rally scheduled. That was when I had a rally scheduled August 27th in Berkeley, and August 26th in San Francisco. It was a Freedom Weekend. And, you know, I start getting these phone calls from reporters, and they say, hey, you know, you're throwing a white supremacist rally in San Francisco. And I'm like, what? And it was phone call after phone call after phone call. All these reporters literally believe that I'm throwing a white supremacist rally. Even when we went down there, we would go around and talk to people, and we would say, hey, have you heard about this rally this weekend? Like, oh, yeah, the white supremacist rally. Like, everyone believed it. It was mass hysteria. It was amazing. But the irony of it, and I swear, this is where I swear God has a sense of humor, it just happened to be this way. We didn't realize this until we were being accused of a white supremacist rally. We looked at our speaker list, and there was only one white speaker.
That's
the rest
funny.
Of them were black, Mexican. We had transsexual. We had males, Japanese. It was we couldn't believe it. So we did a press conference, and we put all the speakers up there. You know, we have a 6'6 Samoan. You know, we have Will Johnson. He's black. And it was just like, this is going to be the worst white supremacist rally ever. How disappointed are you going to be if you're a Klan member and you show up and all the speakers are black or brown?
Now let's do the dichotomy of that, because the guys on the other side were mostly made up of young white men, right?
Always.
Always.
Always, always, always. They're always white. Every single one of them.
Okay.
I have conversations with, so many times I go up to, you know, I have conversations with some black young men, and they'll be like, so what's this talk about you being white supremacist? And I just talk to them, have a conversation, and it always ends well because they know racism. They've seen it.
Right.
You know, and they're like, this guy's not a white supremacist. It is just a white young men who are, you know, I'm not making fun of them, but they're usually gay.
Right.
They just have a huge issue and you can't talk to them. They just yell and they scream.
I know those young, no kidding. And what you're talking about is all those young metrosexuals who, you know, whether they're not gay or not, they still try to project that we're an enlightened, better people just because we are more metrosexual or whatever they're trying to portray. And I thought that's so hilarious when they're coming up guys like, okay, Tiny tells the most funny story about getting involved with this. I don't suppose you might let us tell us about Tiny and how he got involved.
So Tiny got involved because he was one of those guys who hated Trump supporters. This is during the election. He would, he destroyed quite a few bumpers that had Trump stickers on the back. He loved watching Trump supporters get beat up. He would always search those YouTube videos. And he actually did get in a couple fights. He had attacked a couple people. Just this guy who wasn't really political, didn't understand the importance of freedom.
Yeah.
But he was one of the guys that got pulled into the racist. So what happened was, he found out that there was going to be a Trump rally in Vancouver, Washington, which was my rally. And he was excited. He wanted to go, but he had to go to church. So after he's excited to search it up, he was hoping that he would see a bunch of Trump supporters getting beat up. So what happened, though, what came up was my speech. It was about a 20-minute speech, and he listened to it, and he said that it changed his life because he was like, this guy's not a hateful white supremacist, you know, because I was talking about love and unity and freedom and all that stuff. And so he decided to check me out. He reached out to me, and he was so moved by the speech that he actually literally decided to take a car down with a couple of my friends down to Berkeley. And the whole ride down, he was kind of feeling him out and listening to him speak and understanding that they don't really care about the color of your skin. And then we pull up to Berkeley. He gets out of the car, and he's this big 6'6 Samoan, you know, really dark. And all of a sudden, all these people just welcome him in with open arms, with love. Like, hey, brother, what's your name? And then immediately around the corner comes Antifa. He'd never seen them before. There's about 500 of them coming around the corner, dressed in all black, just spewing out pure hatred to everyone that they see. And he spent the whole day literally protecting Trump supporters. And then he became part of the movement that day.
When he tells a story, it's so impressive. And I love when he tells his full name that I won't even try to even pronounce here because it's like 10 syllables long. And so, I was very impressed with Tiny. I when he got up there and he told his story, it was something that, you know, when you hear the truth, it's something that, you know, you know it's the truth. And you know it's something that you believe in, and sometimes when it's coming from a messenger like you, people go, oh, well, I'm hearing the message, but I'm not sure if I'm hearing it right until they start thinking about it. And I think that that's a problem with a lot of the Antifa, and I don't know why they even call them Antifa. They should call them Antifa. They're the anti-fascist fascists because they're the most fascist people that I've ever met. And so I'm like I said, I'm just impressed that you were able to take this to the level that you've been going to. I've got to do another commercial here, but I'm going to do a contest first. And when we get back, I would like to discuss about what's going on with Mayor Wheeler and the police force. Would that be all right with you?
Yeah, sounds good.
All right, man. Well, all right, folks, if you all listen to the radio show, you know that we have a giveaway about this time. And if you would like to get involved with this giveaway, it's from one of our local restaurants, four of them. The gentleman who owns the McDonald's, the local McDonald's restaurants, there's one in Reedsport, there is one in Walmart, and there's one on North Bend and one in Coos Bay. And I can guarantee you every one of them have clean bathrooms and you'll get a smile with your service. So I'd recommend that you always can get a Happy Meal at McDonald's. And if you want to win the contest here, you can get one free dessert of your choice. You can get one free breakfast sandwich of your choice, one free small McCafe beverage, or and a sheet of buy one, get one free if you're the third caller at 541-267-2124, and we'll be right back.
Looking for a new or used firearm? You should get to know the friendly folks at World Pawn Exchange. Located at 1980 Sherman in downtown North Bend, World Pawn Exchange buys, sells, and trades firearms of all types. And with their extensive, ever-changing inventory, they could have just the right firearm for you. If they don't have that gun that you want in stock, they'll be more than happy to special order it for you. World Pawn Exchange in downtown North Bend, where you'll find more than you can possibly imagine.
Well, I was driving across town when my car got down, started lurching and trying to die. Well, luckily there was a shop, and when it struggled to a stop, a nice fella met me right outside. I said, "Man, something's wrong. What the heck is going on?" He said, "I tell you this, I got no doubt. You just relax and don't you worry. We can fix it in a hurry, because your car is what we're all about. We do it all."
Bayshore Auto and RV Repair, your one-stop shop for all your automotive and RV mechanical repairs. Stop by and see Jeff and his friendly staff on Bayshore Drive in Coos Bay.
There's no reason to guess. The verdict is in, and the solid winner continues to be Herbal Choices.
I think everyone knows why Herbal Choices is the leader.
You and I see Herbal Choices the same way, like a part of our family. They know me when I come in, and they're always happy to show me all that's new, including Jim Belushi's new harvest.
Hi, Jim Belushi here. My Belushi Farms private vault is exclusively here, Southern Oregon coast at Herbal Choices. Check it out. It's the only choice.
And no matter where you are, Herbal Choices is close by. Coos Bay, Charleston, and Bandon. They always keep me updated on their website at www.theherbalchoices.com.
No one can compete with Herbal Choices prices. They now have so many locations that they buy large quantities and pass the savings along to their customers. It's their people. Friendly. Always ready to help with knowledgeable answers. It's like dealing with family.
Do not operate a vehicle under the influence of marijuana. For use by people 21 and older, keep out of the reach of children.
We're back in session. It's the Rob Taylor Report. And here he is, Rob Taylor.
Hey, Coos County, if you're joining me, you know that we're talking to Joey Gibson from Patriot Pair. And I want to thank Susan for being the third caller. He won the contest, and we'll get that out to you. Joey, we were talking about how you, your religion and how you came to this and all this, how it built up. And now you're to the point where you're doing this on a regular basis. And you had, let me set this up first. Anyone who's ever done protests or rallies, I know I've done this. I used to do this in Albuquerque. And we would set up, we would be expecting about 1,000 to 3,000 people to show up. And when that happens, the city, especially the law enforcement, they want to know what you're doing. And they want to keep in contact with the person who's the lead person of the rally, which was usually me. And I remember the guy who every time I had one of these rallies, I'd deal with the same person from the police department. And we didn't have phones back then, and so we couldn't give back and forth texts. But he would always come out to the rally, and he knew what route we were taking and where we were going. And they did that for not only our safety, but the safety of the community. And that was something that was going on with Joey. He had an officer there that was a liaison between him and the city of Portland. And, well, there was an incident that happened. And, Joey, I think I'm going to let you pick it up from there, if you would. You with me, Joey? Uh-oh, I think we lost Joey. Well, basically what had happened is that Joey was, he constantly has a person.
It was, we were polite with one another.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So,
we must have missed the first part of that. Could you start over again?
Okay, sorry. Yeah, basically they released 1,000 text messages approximately between me and this officer. And basically the city had a meltdown because we were respectful to one another. And we worked together, and we communicated with one another. And it was interesting because I think that they said that he's a white supremacist. They said I'm a white supremacist. You would think that in 1,000 text messages there would be something that was kind of juicy, but they couldn't find anything. What they don't like, though, is they don't like how Patriot Prayer is communicating with the police. That's the main thing. But he would try to communicate with everybody. That's his job.
Right.
And the interesting thing is the mayor knew that he was communicating with me because the Portland police, in response to the mayor's, you know, throwing the officer under the bus, they released text messages between that same officer and the top aide with the mayor. And he was relaying all the information that I was giving the officer straight to the mayor's office because the mayor is the police commissioner.
Right.
So he knew exactly what was going on. Now, the city had such a huge meltdown that they literally had to have a listening. They literally had to have a listening session to where 300 people or so showed up at a church to complain to the mayor and the police chief about my connections with the police department.
Did you go
and
to
the
that?
Mayor,
did you go to that meeting?
I wanted to so bad, but I was on the airplane.
Oh,
I wanted to go so bad.
Yeah,
it would have been so. So
it looked interesting.
Someone said anything in support of me, the whole crowd would start hissing like little demons. It was weird.
Weird.
So if I was there, they probably would have burnt down the church.
It's amazing now. It's a listening meeting, you know, and then you show up and they're going to hiss at you. Oh, that's rich. So where does it lay now? I think from what I understood, from what I read, the officer has been pulled from duty.
I think that he's been pulled from the response team, basically the team that works on all the protests. And they pretty much, indirectly banned any communication with me, which is going to make any rally in the future more dangerous.
I was just going to say.
The crazy thing.
Yeah.
What's that?
I was going to say, that's crazy. Yeah.
That is crazy because the funny thing, here's what's really funny, is that if the police ever have to use physical force, say they have to clear out Antifa or whatever, they get sued. So the best thing that they can do is de-escalate ahead of time.
Right.
And this officer did everything he can to de-escalate ahead of time in terms of trying to get me to stay away from big crowds. You know, like if Portland's having a separate event that has nothing to do with politics, you know, just trying to keep me away from there, trying to keep me away from Antifa. And there's several text messages where he's begging me to leave the city. And there's several times where I actually comply because they said they're losing control.
That's too much. And just the fact, like you said, you know that Wheeler had to have known what's going on. So do you think this is personal, a vendetta against you in some way?
Oh, a lot of things he does. Yeah, it's very personal. He doesn't like me because I call him out all the time. I'm one of the few people who have a voice that go into Portland and call out the hypocrisy of Portland and the hate and how bad it is, you know, constantly calling out the drug problem and the rising cost of the living, you know, the rising cost, especially when it comes to property taxes.
Uh-huh.
And so what he's trying to do is he's trying to say racist, 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 white supremacist. So all these people look at that instead of looking at the major problems with the city. But he's trying to undermine the police department right now. They're making an attempt right now. They want to be able to collect information on people like me. The police department are not working with them, and so now he's trying to undermine the entire police department.
And I can believe that, which it adds to his benefit because it gives him the political capital to go back in and say, oh, look, even though I caused the problem, I found a solution for it, because that's what politicians do. Many times they cause the problem, and then they come in with a solution so that they can show that they are the ones who are needed for these type of jobs. So, Joey, where do you go from here? What's coming up? What happens now?
Well, the thing is I've really, you know, you really opened my eyes. I remember I was sitting at the computer and I found that Oregonian article on what you did with the eight counties. And it really opened my eyes in terms of really bringing power back to a local level. And I've really enjoyed going into areas where people don't want to kill me and they actually like my message.
Isn't that nice?
It's really, really nice. It's so weird to have people come up and shake my hand instead of come up and trying to punch me. It's like totally different. But I think that I really want to build almost a revolution in Washington State where people are so fed up with Olympia and Seattle that we just say we got to take the power back and bring it back to our counties. And one of the selling points to these city council members or council members is to say, hey, we want to empower you guys. We want to empower you guys to bring freedom back to your county, take it back away from Seattle. And I'm really enjoying just traveling around the state and giving speeches at random spots and going back to just giving a good message and inspiring people. One thing I love doing is, see, I was inspired. I'm just one man, so I want to go around. And if I can just inspire one person that decides to be an activist once a month, I think we can really make some huge change. And that's what we need. There's so many leaders that are sitting at home. They don't know it yet. They don't believe in themselves. They believe the problems are too big. And so, you know, I really love waking people up and getting them involved. It's an addiction is what it is.
And it is an addiction. It's something that once you get involved with this, it gets to the point where it almost takes over your life. It becomes, and you use the word yourself, a calling, where it's almost there's something that is just pulling you as hard as you can to do something because you can see the wrong, you can see the injustice, and all you're trying to do is bring a little bit of righteousness back to where the people have been led astray with these false promises of, oh, the government's going to solve your problem, when in reality the government usually causes the problem and then they just add to it the bigger they get. So I'm so glad that I had you on today, because I think that you're someone who is inspirational. I think there are people out there, as you said, are leaders. We've got leaders who are sitting out there. They just need to stop yelling at their TV, calm down, educate themselves, and move on to going to these public meetings. We don't have a whole lot of time left, but could you tell me where can people get in touch with you if they want to get in touch with you?
If they go to gibsonforfreedom.com. The best thing to do is sign up on the email list and put their cell phone number so they can get updates on my events. And then they can also go to Patriot Prayer on Facebook.
Oh, that's perfect. And so in case anyone doesn't know, me and Joey, Joey doesn't live in Portland. You live in Vancouver, right?
Yeah, I can't live in Portland.
You can't live in Portland. I don't blame you. Who could, unless you wear pajamas and you suck on a pacifier? I mean, it's... And so, and that's the 30-year-olds, folks, and I'm not kidding you. You and I are going to get together on an issue. I've got a gentleman up there who's willing to be a chief petitioner, and we're going to do something crazy here. We're waiting for our Second Amendment Sanctuary Ordinance to get out of court, because it's right now being challenged in Columbia County. And when we get that out of the court in Columbia County, and by the way, I just got a notice that they're going to put back the date of the court date. So it's no longer March 6th. It looks like they're going to be changing that. So I'll get back to you when that date is. But when we go through the court case, and my attorney is pretty sure that we're going to win on that, we're going to be able to take that Second Amendment Sanctuary Ordinance, and I know you're going to be one of the chief petitioners. I'm going to be one of the chief petitioners. Then we're going to have a gentleman who lives there, because you have to have someone in Multnomah County to file this. And we're going to file a Second Amendment Sanctuary Ordinance in the city of Multnomah. Joey, what do you think's going to happen?
I don't know, but I'm excited to find out.
I'm excited to find out. And so you folks stay in tune, because as you hear that music, the hour is up. And if you want to get in touch with Joey, just go to those websites he just mentioned. Joey, thank you for coming on. I appreciate that, man.
Thanks for having me.
Not a problem. And we'll be in touch. We'll be back to you at some point in time. And until then, we'll be right back.
We're back in session. It's the Rob Taylor Report. And here he is, Rob Taylor.
Hey, Coos County. I'm glad you're joining me today. What an incredible guest. What an incredible young man out there doing stuff that he doesn't have to do. Nobody is asking Joey Gibson to go out there and take his life into his own hands every time he goes and prays in the middle of Portland. Who would have thought just 10 years ago that if you went to the center of Portland and decided to have a prayer rally, that you would get attacked by the Antifa, The reason I call them the anti-fa-fas is because they are the anti-fascist fascist. And the reason you know this is if you ever go to one of Joey's events, that most of the people, almost all the people there, and Joey's side of the rally will be, like he said, people of many different colors, many different backgrounds, talking about the same thing, having limited government and more freedom, more liberty for the people. And on the other side, you'll have these little ninjas in black mask, in black outfits, and sometimes camouflage. Sometimes they have weapons. Sometimes they just have bottles of urine that they want to toss. And they go nuts because they don't want free speech. And not only do they not want free speech, they want to be able to tell you what speech you can and cannot have for anything that you want to say. And that's what's really insulting when you have people like Joey out there trying to do something that many young people should be doing and being cheered on for getting it done. But it's like the world has been turned upside down, and now we are fighting fascists in this country. And it doesn't matter whether they're fascist, socialist, communist. Collectivism is a disease. It's a disease of force. It's a disease of need. And it's an ideology that only breeds one thing, and that's despotism. Tyranny. That's what you're going to get from collectivism. Because for collectivism to function, for those people to put up their system, the system of government, to have the government own everything so the collective can tell you and me and everyone else what to do, they have to use force. And the only way they can use force is if they disarm the people of this country. And that's one of the reasons that I've been working so hard to protect the Second Amendment and our Second Amendment rights that are being whittled away in Washington State and Oregon State and many, many other states across this country. From sea to shining sea, gun owners are under attack. We're being maligned. We're being marginalized. We're being called all kinds of names. And why? Because they have to disarm us. And because collectivism is an ideology of force. And once again, I know people are going, well, it's the socialist, it's the fascist, it's the communist. It doesn't matter. Like I said, collectivism is the disease no matter what ideology you put behind it. You know, that's the difference between 1984, the book 1984 written by George Orwell, and the book A Brave New World. Written by Huxley. In the book 1984, government comes to you in the form of jackbooted thugs that imposes their will upon you. Whereas in A Brave New World, they come to you with a warm, fuzzy blanket telling you that they're going to keep you warm and coddle you. But in the end, both books end up in the same place where the individual dies and individualism dies and the government and the collective, no matter whether they're coming with you with a warm blanket or it's a bunch of jackbooted thugs delivering it, it's the same thing. It's the domination of the minority by the majority. And it don't matter what color you are. And you know, and that's another thing. Joey talks about racism and how they try to portray everyone as a race. You know, that's a word that was created by Trotsky back in the last century. And it was something that he created so he could put people in different groups. You're black, I'm white, he's Asian. That's groupthink. That's identity politics. That's what I'm fighting against, because I see everyone as an individual. And I believe every individual has the same equal rights under the government. And that's why I don't believe in social justice. I believe in equal justice for all. Because I don't want to be judged by the group that I belong to, or better yet, the group that they want to put me into, because they want to compartmentalize me. And they're going to compartmentalize all of us. We're all going to get pigeonholed. What group do you belong to? What rights will you get? Well, speaking of that, one of the things that is happening right now is that the Confederated Tribes of the Coos, Lower Umpqua, and Sisslu Indians have decided that they wanted to create a historical preservation designation for the entire Bay of Coos Bay. You should go take a look at the map. It's just a map of the entire bay. And they're doing it, and they're saying they're doing this is because they want to protect more of their archaeological sites. There's already protections for those sites, so I'm not buying that. But if that's what they want to say, that's perfectly fine. And I'm not mad at the Indian tribes by any means. This is their right. We voted for people. I didn't vote for them. Probably you didn't vote for them. But we voted for people who decided to create a system where anyone can create a historic preservation designation. So don't get mad at the Indian tribes. You know, it's like people who get mad at the police officer who pulls them over because they got a speeding ticket or a seatbelt ticket. And they sit there and they argue with the cop. Well, there's no reason to argue with the cop. The cop didn't do it. It's the legislature. You know, the guy who comes around every 2 or 4 years with his hand out telling them how well he's going to protect your rights and keep more taxes in your wallet. Keep more money in your wallet and keep it from going to taxes, I should say. Well, those are the guys you need to blame. Well, those are the guys you need to blame for creating the system that created the ability for the Indians to go to the Oregon Parks and Rec Department and ask for a historical preservation designation. It's ridiculous. Well, on November 1st, 2018, the Confederate tribes, they filed for an application to place 20 square miles of land surrounding the Coos Bay on the National Registry of historical places. The only way to stop the government from listing the area on the National Registry of Historic Places is for the majority of affected landowners, that's over 1,600 of them, to file an official historic district objection form with the state of Oregon by May 10th, 2019. That means we only just got a few months. It's March right now. It's March 1st. Well, you got till May 10th, folks. And you shouldn't have to do this. You shouldn't have to jump through the hoops. In a free country, nobody should have to opt out of anything. You should be asked if you want to opt in. But, you know, that's the crazy collectivist government that we're living in. So you have till May 10th of 2019 to get out of this crazy designation. And even though most of the area is submerged, because it's the bay, the designation will affect properties inland from the high tide line. The tribe is making this proposal for the area as a way to streamline the process of becoming an officially recognized tribe by the feds. They are doing this so they can receive more benefits and have more authority over what they're claiming as their land. It may have been their land 200 or so years ago, but I've got news for you folks in the Indian tribe. Your people fought a war with the government of the United States and you lost. And so to the victor goes the spoils. We shouldn't have to be putting up with this. This is something that we should have dealt with many years ago. And this is why I've been so opposed to many of these Indian reservations. The Indians should have been allowed to assimilate with us. And once again, you can't blame the Indians for the reservations. You have to blame our government. You can go back to Andrew Jackson for this one. The Trail of Tears was nothing more than white people trying to get Indians off the property that they thought that they could use in a better way and sent them off on the reservation. And now we're stuck with this kind of nonsense where we have two groups of people, the Indians and Americans, who are living with two sets of rules, and it's ridiculous. But that's what we've got. And now the Park and Rec Commission, they voted unanimously to go ahead and recognize this as a historic area. And they sent the nomination, because they only make the nomination. The actual designation comes from the National Registry of Historic Places. And the Parks and Rec Commission of Oregon, they made this unanimous vote on February 22nd at the Mill Casino, which is owned by the Coquille Indians. Can anyone tell me why is the Oregon Parks and Rec meeting at land owned by what they would consider a sovereign nation that's not the American nation? I mean, you can't have it both ways. If the Indian tribes are going to claim that they're sovereign nations, then why is the state of Oregon meeting at the Mill? That in itself is questionable. But the people of Coos County, you have to get the word out for this opt-out, because it's going to be up to you. It's going to be up to you, the landowners, the business owners, and all the houses that are out there in those 1,600 areas. It's going to be up to you to decide whether you want to go through with this, because it's going to take at least 51% of those 1,600 areas, those 1,600 properties, the owners of those properties, it's going to take 51% of them to opt out. Well, there is a group that's trying to help you, and the group is called Coos Concerned Property Owners, and it's made up of many different businesses and organizations and private individuals, well, who are just tired of having more rules and regulations imposed upon them. And if you want to get involved, you need to go down to their office, which is located at 281 South Broadway, which is in downtown Coos Bay, just a few doors down from the Prefontaine mural. And you need to talk to those folks, because they have notaries there, and they have the opt-out forms, and their hours are between Monday through Friday from 9 to 6 p.m., and they also have a website. So if you're someone who cannot make it out to downtown, to 281 South Broadway, where their office is located, then you need to go to their website, which is at www.coosconcernedpropertyowners.com. One word. Boy, I wish they would have shortened that. But it's coosconcernedpropertyowners.com. And I recommend all of you get on your computers, go there, and take a look at all the people who are involved with this. You know, it's funny, some of those people are the same people that I fought against on this urban renewal area, because I believe that taking more taxes and taking it from the regular taxing property districts and using it for private business is, once again, theft of property, because you're taking it from one group of people to give it to another group of private people. And in an urban renewal, in that case, it would, in the urban renewal area that I'm talking about over by the port, that would have been more money for the LNG project. And I think they should pay for their own infrastructure projects. But it's funny that some of the people that are on this list who are opposing this historic designation, they don't want their property taken by the Oregon Parks or Rec and put under the authority of the Indian tribe. No, they don't want their property taken. But when it comes to urban renewal or enterprise zones or any other tax incentive programs or subsidy programs, anything that goes to help their business, boy, they're the first in line with their hat in hand and their palms up, ready to get it greased like nobody's business. So I hope you all recognize that all the people that are involved with this group, the Coos Concerned Property Owners, why don't you ask them, when they're done with this fight against the Parks and Rec and against the National Historic Places, why don't you ask them if they'd stop stealing your property in the guise of taxes? That'd be a good idea. And with that, I think we're going to go to a commercial, and we'll be right back.
Stop in today to the all-new one-stop gun shop, Hole-in-the-Wall Gun Shop in Coos Bay. Your area leader in quality firearms, Hole-in-the-Wall Gun Shop proudly features the top brands of new and used handguns, hunting rifles, black rifles, antique and collectible guns, ammo, mace, and more. Gun cleaning and repair, expert advice, and handgun safety classes for concealed carry permits are offered too. So stop into Hole-in-the-Wall Gun Shop across from Cumyon's on Highway 101 South in Coos Bay. We buy, sell, or trade.
Hi, Danny at Far West Tire and Auto here. Sometimes deer like to jaywalk, or even once in a while a basketball forgets to look both ways before bouncing across the street. When those moments happen, be ready for the stop with the Michelin Premier All-Season Tire, a tire design with more performance in mind. Far West Tire and Auto on Highway 101 Coos Bay. Always the right tire, always the right price.
The RV business is booming at the Boomin' Y, and Gibbs RV is looking for nice pre-owned RVs to consign or buy. Gibbs RV makes it so simple. They will come to your location, give you a fair appraisal, and help take care of all the paperwork. It doesn't get any easier than that. So let the professionals at Gibbs RV take the hassle out of selling or consigning your RV. Stop by and see them today at 1845 Ocean Boulevard in Coos Bay by the Big Boomin' Y in Empire, or check them out at GibbsRV.com.
We'll be right back. We're back in session. It's the Rob Taylor Report. And here he is, Rob Taylor.
Hey, Coos County, thank you for joining me. And if you want to come in and chime in on the subjects that we're talking about, you want to talk about Patriot Prayer, my first guest, Joey, and you have any questions that I might be able to answer, or you want to talk about some of the historic designations that are going on, or any issue that you would like to discuss, you can give me a call here at 541-267-2124. We're more than happy to take your calls. And if you disagree with me on something I'm talking about, you think I'm wrong, please call in. We can do this very simply. We can go over and talk very, very calmly about what's going on and how you may disagree with me. I'm not going to bite your head off. I'm just a big old pussy cat. That's all I am. And I'm telling you. So another thing that's been going on, and I know people are going to be very interested because this is something that's going to affect you directly. There are open positions for Coos County Special District's election in May. This is all the districts like the fire department, the school districts, the water districts, I think the airport district is one. Well, all of those are coming up, and I know they're not the glamour positions, you know, like the commissioner. Everyone wants to be the commissioner, your head of the county, or someone, you know, it's nice to be the legislator. Legislators carry pretty good weight. I mean, I have great respect for our legislators. Well, there's a couple I don't have respect for, but the two that I have, Dallas Hurd and David Brock Smith, you know, two good guys there. And, you know, these people are in positions of great authority. And they didn't just get there overnight. They had to start out at lower positions. And in fact, I would recommend that everyone should take a try at these lower positions, because the special elections are very important for local decisions. There is going to be millions of dollars going through the school districts, especially with the community enhancement plan and when they get that up and running. And it would be very nice to have a fiscal conservative on these boards. So I want all of you to consider running. If you're someone who's tired of watching the government spend your money like gangsters, then you need to get involved. You know, we just talked to Joey in the first hour, and this guy goes down in the middle of Portland, and he prays, and he gets attacked by 200 Antifa, the anti-fascist, and all he's doing is praying in the middle of Portland. And all I'm asking you to do is take one day a month to become a school board member, or to become a member of the Port District or the College Board, and stand your ground. Tell them you're tired of watching these entities, especially the college, especially the airport, go through your money like gangbusters. These people are spending your tax dollars. Don't you think you should be there? I think so. And one of the things you can do to get support for these districts is go to one of your local parties, either the Democrats or the Republicans. And the filing period right now is from February 9th, which started last month, and it's going to go through this month until the 21st. So you got until March 21st to file at the Coos County Clerk's Office and try to become a candidate. And they'll give you a list of all the positions that are open. And here's a little trick. If you want to be a for sure winner, what you do is you wait for the very last hour on March 21st, about 4 o'clock, 4:30, you go down to the clerk's office, you go see which positions are open, and you file for the one that nobody has filed for. So you're guaranteed a win. And I can guarantee you that some of those positions will be left open. I just looked at it last night, and it seemed like several of them. There is no one there who's applied to be for these positions. And I'm going to try to get some of these candidates on, but I'm only going to have candidates on this show who are actually facing a competition in their race, meaning there has to be two or more people in your race to come on the show. Because anyone who's facing no challengers, why would I even have them on the show? To talk about what they're going to do anyway? Well, we'll have them on when they win, because if they're not facing a challenge, I don't want to hear it. I want to have the people who are actually facing a challenge. So if you go out to your local political parties, the Democrats or the Republicans. You can talk to them about what position you want to help with, and they will help you. In fact, last night, I went to the Republican meeting, which is usually held at the mall. They only have a headquarters during the election season because it's very expensive to rent those things. But I went out to the mall last night where they're having a meeting, and this is what's great about our local Republican Party. Anyone of any affiliation can go out there to the party. Now, I'm no longer a Republican. I was a Republican back when Janie Germond was running for Congress against Peter DeFazio. I joined when I became her campaign manager, and I stayed a Republican all the way up to Terry Greer's first campaign. After that, I knew I was going to be coming on the radio show, and I wanted to kind of lose any affiliation that I had so I could at least appear to be objective. I like to think I'm an objective person. I like to look at everything objectively, but I became a non-affiliated voter. Well, last night at their meeting, there was a gentleman there who just got completely upset with me because I wasn't a registered Republican, and he started getting into my face and yelling, and I'll tell you what, that's just inappropriate at any meeting. And he's a friend of mine, and so I couldn't understand why he had so much animosity and anger because I wasn't a registered Republican. And come to find out, he's a social conservative. And one of the things that he was angry about was a personal issue, and I don't like to get into those personal issues, but he was upset with the radio show because I have allowed a marijuana dispensary as one of my sponsors. And many social conservatives, well, they don't approve of that. And that's fine. But it's not my problem, and I don't care if you like who I have on as a sponsor. Because I've got something that's called loyalty. And the dispensary that's my sponsor on this show, the name of the sponsor, the people, the business is Herbal Choices. They've been allowing me to go down and get petition signatures on many different issues because the owner of that business is a real libertarian, is a real fiscal conservative. The thing is he's not a social conservative. And that's what I kind of liked about our local Republican Party is that you can show up there and talk about different issues without having to worry most of the time about someone attacking you because they disagree with you. Well, last night, some guy got into my face and we had a little kerfuffle and I took care of it. You know, I don't let anyone get in my face without me telling them exactly what I think of them and putting them back in their place. And anyone else who wants to get in my face, I hope you don't mind a fist in your eye. Because that's not appropriate. And I hope that that person, I hope he's listening today, because it's not appropriate that he does it to anyone else, because I've seen him do it to other people. And the Republican Party, especially the local Republican Party, they're not like the state party. These guys have been working really hard to find good conservative candidates. And if you want to go down to the Republican parties and join their meetings, you can go on Facebook and look up Coos County Republican Party, and they always have their meeting announcements on that Facebook page. So I recommend that if you want to get involved and you want to run for these open positions in these special districts election, that you start with your own political party because they can help you out. They can give you advice. And plus, we don't want two conservative Republicans running in the same position when there are so many open positions out there. And once again, it's not because they're Republicans, it's because they're fiscally conservative. As an objective person, I think it's wise to keep your budget under control. It's wise to not spend more than you take in. That's just me. Just call me objective. And so that's why if you people want to get involved, look up at your county clerk's office, find a position, and you have no excuse. And I think we're going to have to go to another commercial here. And when we get back, I've got a few more things to discuss about a swimming pool that Bandon is trying to put in. I know it's going to be a great topic, and we'll be right back.
For 20 years, the Oregon Firearms Federation has been Oregon's only no-compromise voice for gun rights. While other organizations who claim to speak for gun owners made deals to bargain away your liberty and property, OFFICE stood face-to-face with the gun grabbers in Salem to protect your rights. But there's never been a more dangerous time to be a gun owner in Oregon, and we need your help. To become part of the fight for Second Amendment rights and to sign up for free legislative alerts, please visit our website at OregonFirearms.org. That's OregonFirearms.org.
In just a fast few minutes from right now, you can have life insurance for up to $500,000 without taking a medical exam and without leaving your home. We're Fast Life, and we're going to make this easy and fast. Odds are that you don't have enough insurance, or you're paying way too much for what you got, or you don't have any, and that's not good. Listen, nobody likes to think about life insurance, but we're grown-ups now, so call and protect your family. 1-800-254-9567 or go to fastlife.life. You've got insurance? That's great, but you may be able to get more coverage and pay less than what you're paying now. And with no medical exam, you can get it right over the phone, and that's fast. Faster than a speeding bullet? No, but fast. And we also said we make it easy. So call and get quotes, then submit an application over the phone, and that's it. And that's easy. Get approved, and coverage starts instantly. And that's fast. Faster than the speed of light? No, but fast. Call 1-800-254-9567 or go to fastlife.life. Fastlife.life. It's revolutionary. It's Fast Life.
If you run your own business, when you're not on the job, you're on the road. In your van. Signs that say detour and do not enter are just plain bad for business. Well, here's a sign that's great for business. It says 0% financing and up to 2 years complimentary scheduled maintenance on Mercedes-Benz Sprinter or Metris vans. Powerful, capable, and affordable. That's Mercedes-Benz van power. With pioneering safety technologies and low total cost of ownership, Mercedes-Benz vans are the right choice for your business. Check out the full lineup of Mercedes-Benz vans starting at just $25,995. 0% financing and up to 2 years complimentary scheduled maintenance. That's van power for all. Mercedes-Benz. Vans. Born to run.
Starting at price refers to base model Metris worker cargo van. Excludes all options, taxes, title, registration, transportation charge, and dealer prep fee. Please see your dealer or go to mvvans.com for further details and exclusions.
Are your medical bills piling up due to cancer or another serious illness? You are not alone. Many people face this challenge. Here's how Coventry Direct can help. You can receive an immediate cash payment by selling your life insurance policy. If you have $100,000 or more of life insurance, you may be eligible to sell your policy, even a term policy. To find out if you qualify, call Coventry Direct today at 1-800-510-2800 to speak to one of our policy specialists. That's 1-800-510-2800. The cash you receive from selling your policy can be used to help pay medical bills or whatever you choose to give you financial security and peace of mind. Call Coventry Direct at 1-800-510-2800 or visit us at CoventryDirect.com. Coventry Direct, giving you the cash you need when you need it most. Coventry Direct is a marketing company and will refer qualified policies to a licensed entity.
We're back in session. It's the Rob Taylor Report. And here he is, Rob Taylor.
Hey, everybody. I know I promised you we'd be talking about the pool, but before I do, I have to go to some guy who's really important. That's Tim from Tom and Giggs. Tim, are you there?
Good afternoon, sir.
Hey, I know my producer called you earlier, and you were under a truck, they said. Are you okay?
It happens out here a lot. You know what I mean?
It's, yeah.
I'm not afraid to get my fingernails dirty.
That's good. I'm glad someone is, because I'll tell you what, you know, when I hung out with anyone in any group in school, it was always the gearheads, because they always knew how to work on their cars. You know what I mean? So those were the guys you hung out with, you know?
That's right. Yep. Yep. They were the cool ones. They had the cool cars and all that stuff, man.
Yep.
I didn't have a lot of money then, but I liked working on cars, but boy, I was always kind of envious of those guys that had them old Chevelles and stuff. And that was pretty cool.
Yep.
Have a Chevelle, man, you're dialed.
Yeah, and you and I are about the same age, so we had all the cool cars. You remember the Road Runners, like you said, the Chevelles, and you know, all the Chargers. I mean, and they were the old monster cars, you know what I mean? It was,
and now they're worth, you know, gazillions of dollars, and it's just craziness.
Yeah.
You know, there's still a lot of those cars out there, and I really enjoy doing the exhaust systems on those cars. It's really awesome to, you know, a guy brings down a regulator with open headers or maybe no exhaust at all, wants to do it all. And, you know, you get all that stuff done with the X-pipe and, you know, either Flowmasters or Magnaflows or whatever. There's a lot of different mufflers now, of course, but it's just to see that guy's face light up the first time you fire that thing up, and it's just awesome. And it's like,
yeah,
you know, it's just like tires and wheels. It makes the whole car, but you fire that thing up, it sounds cool. It's like, holy moly, that's just awesome. But it's cool. That's, you know, that's the old school way. And you know, the new cars are neat too, but there's something about the old stuff that just is different. And you know, that's why they call them classics or whatever. I mean, they're we'll never probably be there again, but it's fun doing them. And, you know, we do all kinds of cool stuff, but whether it's you know, an old car or a new car, whether it's alignments, brakes, shocks, tires, wheels, cars or trucks, winches, lights, tonneau covers, all the Nerf bar steps, all the different towing products, and, you know, you name it. If it's an accessory, we can get it or we got it. And Josh knows where to get it, and we usually try to find you to get you the best deal. And, you know, sometimes there's two or three products that look very similar. People will be shopping and stuff on the Internet, which I don't have a problem with, but, you know, try to give us a shot first before you buy something off the Internet. But there's different qualities of things that are on the Internet. It may look the same, but they're not. And different materials, and they all look on a picture, they look identical. But so that's where our expertise comes in a little bit. We can steer people in the right direction and say, this is why we don't do these, because of this and that. So you try to learn. If something we don't know about, we'll find out about it and try to help you out. So, you know, whether it's an alignment or you got a, you know, a bad shock or you need a stock muffler for your Honda car, need a spray and bed liner, you name it, or an RC car. You know, everybody's getting into that. And of course, now the good weather, finally, a little sunshine, makes you feel a little better. But swing in, check us out. We're here from 10 to 2 tomorrow on Saturdays, and, of course, 8 to 5 during the week. And, you know, easy to find us down here at the shop, 135 South Shoneman, Coos Bay, just right behind the Most Car Wash. And the phone number, 541-888-4660. And be happy to see anybody comes down. We always like seeing new faces come in, and we see a lot of people from Roseburg and Eugene come down now, a lot of RC stuff, and they didn't realize we did all the other things too. So it's kind of cool to see new faces, and we're just trucking on and trying to expand and do better, and it's a pleasure being on. And I do have a quote, though, by the way.
All right.
We're back in the old days. Said the difference between a welfare state and a totalitarian state is just a matter of time. So we better take control here. We better start getting some people that know what the heck's going on and get some common sense, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Like Rob Taylor for president or something. Well, maybe not that, but let's just still go for governor.
There
get
you
our,
go.
Get our commie out of office there, Miss Kate Brown. So, anyway, it's pretty awesome.
Well, thanks for the notification. I'll be running for governor. And
cool. Hold on for just a second. Hold on. I got a special guest.
Oh, okay.
Hi, how you doing?
Pretty good.
I was just listening to you on the radio. I think we should vote for Rick and Morty for president of the United States of America. I think we'd go into a special area on that one.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
I appreciate you, Rob. Thank you, and hope you have a great weekend, my friend, and thanks for letting us spout off, and hopefully everybody out there is going to get out and vote. It's only a little while away, so anyway.
You got it. Right.
Get her done.
Thank you, Tim. I appreciate it. I'll tell you what, the city of Bandon, in their infinite wisdom, is going to put a public opinion poll for the placement of the Bandon pool. Now, this is absolutely ridiculous. This is something that's absolutely infuriating for me because I'm getting sick of being asked this question over and over and over again there, folks. I don't know what the hell is the matter with the city officials out there, except for I did get a response from Brian Vick. He said that he's not for the pool. He thinks they have a really lousy business plan, and he doesn't support it. So he asked me not to include him on my tirade against the city councilors abandoning the mayor down there. I'll tell you what. We've already been asked twice about this pool. They've done the question in many different ways, two different times, and each time the people, the voters abandoned, have not only said no, but with a huge extreme margins, we have said hell no to your damn pool. I wish you would stop listening to the pool pushers out there in Bandon and start listening to the citizens who pay your bills. Yeah, I'm a little bit upset about this. I'll gauge myself a little bit. But talking about gauging, this is what the paper said. In an effort to gauge public opinion, like we need to gauge public opinion. We already know what public opinion is because we've already voted on it. But let me go again. And to gauge the public opinion on whether the proposed Bandon Aquatic Center, my butt, should be located in a city park, the city of Bandon is taking a non-binding advisory survey, meaning it doesn't mean nothing. There's no controls on it. There's no way of knowing if it's real or not real. It's nothing but BS because you know what surveys are. There's no control on it. There's no mechanism to know that this is right. So the survey will be inserted in the March billing of all Bandon utility customers. And the city is asking people to return the surveys with their opinion checked in the appropriate box. Yeah, well, when you put that opinion in that appropriate box under no, I don't want to pull, I want you to write underneath there, not only no do I want to pull, but hell no, I don't want to pull, and don't ask me again because I'm tired of you insulting the intelligence of your voters. It's getting a little ridiculous, Bandon. Madam Mayor, and were we supposed to trust you to do these surveys? You're a liar. All during the last campaign, when we had a commissioner, John Sweet, running, and one of the big issues was that Bandon Marsh. You were on the radio every hour saying, "Oh, John Sweet fixed the Bandon Marsh." It was a lie. Why you were saying that people on Prosper were having their animals eaten alive by mosquitoes and you didn't give a damn. All you cared about was the next election, Mayor. Well, we're getting sick of it. And we're getting sick of people, especially our representatives, who just cannot take the right answer. And the answer for this poll, because it's already been asked twice, is no. This survey is a joke. The results of this survey really won't mean much because without the official approval of the council, which you shouldn't give, no matter what the results of the survey is, this should go back to the voters. Of course, we don't want to be asked again. So for you to put it in a survey is ridiculous. So that's my rant on that. And I'm getting sick of this question. So please, if you are in Bandon and you get this March bill, the utility bill, make sure and fill out that survey. And would you please tell the city where they can go with their pool? Yeah, that's pretty much where I am with that. I think we've got another giveaway. Let me calm down. Let me get the blood pressure back down here. Yeah, we have a wonderful giveaway for one of the most best places in the world, Lucky Star Restaurant, the Chinese restaurant at the bottom of Newmark Hill and Highway 101. We all know where it's at. We're giving away the house special, and that includes barbecue pork, sweet and sour pork, fried shrimp, spring roll, pork fried rice, and pork chow mein. All of this can be yours if you are the third caller at 541-267-2124. And when we get back, we're going to have some food for thought with that old radical, Jim Bice.
Well, I was driving across town when my car got down, started lurching and trying to die. Well, luckily there was a shop, and when it struggled to a stop, a nice fella met me right outside. I said, "Man, something's wrong. What the heck is going on?" He said, "I tell you this, I got no doubt. You just relax and don't you worry. We can fix it in a hurry because your car is what we're all about. We do it all."
Bayshore Auto and RV Repair, your one-stop shop for all your automotive and RV mechanical repairs. Stop by and see Jeff and his friendly staff on Bayshore Drive in Coos Bay.
Looking for a new or used firearm? You should get to know the friendly folks at World Pawn Exchange. Located at 1980 Sherman in downtown North Bend, World Pawn Exchange buys, sells, and trades firearms of all types. And with their extensive, ever-changing inventory, they could have just the right firearm for you. If they don't have that gun that you want in stock, they'll be more than happy to special order it for you. World Pawn Exchange in downtown North Bend, where you'll find more than you can possibly imagine.
the clear leader. Herbal Choices. Join the Herbal Choices happy family for best selection. 100 strains, always fresh. Unlike stores that always have the same old products, there's always something new at Herbal Choices. 100 strains and growing. And check Jim Belushi's new harvest. Just in again and better than ever at Herbal Choices. Coos Bay, Charleston, and Bandon. And online at theherbalchoices.com.
Hey, Jim Belushi here. Herbal Choices on the Southern Oregon coast is where you can find my new harvest. Belushi's Private Vault. Check it out.
And reasons are clear. With 100 strains, Herbal Choices sells so much product that everything is always fresh. And there seems to be something new every time I see my Herbal Choices happy family. All our friends agree. The clear winner is Herbal Choices. The only choice.
Check it out. It's the only choice.
Do not operate a vehicle under the influence of marijuana. For use by people 21 and older, keep out of the reach of children.
And now, here's some food for thought from Jim Bice.
I notice the Democrats are trying to counter the Make America Great Again, the MAGA hats, with one of their own. It's a blue cap with the slogan, Make America, America Again. And at first, I couldn't quite grasp just what that means. Then it dawned on me. What they're wishing for is an America that never existed, except in their most exciting fantasies. Then, of course, they could be referring to America under President Obama. A golden age for liberals when the president governed by illegal executive orders, many of which were overturned by the courts. A time with high unemployment, gross overregulation, high taxes, and a war on the energy industry. The very industry that makes the American lifestyle possible. The sad part is that they're getting what they want. Even as I speak here, the totally Democrat-controlled legislature in Salem is busy passing laws based on agendas rather than reality. They want statewide rent control, supposedly to make available what they call affordable housing. In places that this scheme has been tried, it's resulted in a reduction in the construction of low to moderate cost housing units because there's no profit in doing so. The solution was, of course, for the taxpayers to subsidize so-called affordable housing. But that's the next step. Trust me on this one. Another law they're trying to pass is the energy cap and trade. My research found credible studies that estimated energy costs under this law would rise anywhere from 22 to 55%. Let's just go at the low end and say a 25% increase in your energy prices. That means 25% more for your electricity and 25% more to fuel your vehicle. But that's only the beginning. There'll be 25% added to the energy costs of food production, 25% added to the energy costs of manufacturing, and 25% added to the fuel cost to transport virtually everything you eat and use. And all these increased costs will be paid by you, the consumer. Oh, and how much impact will this have on saving the environment? According to several experts on this kind of thing, an amount so small overall that it will be almost immeasurable. Then we have the bevy of gun control laws they want to pass, ostensibly to save society from people using firearms illegally. The only problem with this argument is that not one of their proposals will affect criminals or those intent on using a firearm to commit a crime. The FBI crime statistics tell us the majority of those using firearms illegally obtain them through what they call other than traditional and legal means. We know that criminals and those intent on doing harm to others don't obey the law, so the only people affected by these proposed laws will be law-abiding citizens. And we know these oh-so-knowledgeable legislators, these Einsteins of history and the Constitution, have no concerns whatever about violating your First, Second, and Fourth Amendment rights. After all, an armed populace just can't be properly controlled. Notice the commonality with all these Democrat endeavors. They all take more of your money, restrict your God-given rights, and exert more government control over your life. If they had to adhere to the truth in advertising laws, the new slogan for their hats should be, "Make America Venezuela." You know, Venezuela, the socialist Democrats' fantasy come true. The country that used to be the wealthiest in South America and now is one of the poorest. If you don't know what's going on in Venezuela, that's because the corrupt fake news media hardly reports on it. Do a little research and look it up for yourself. Venezuela has some real problems brought about by many of the same laws and policies the Democrats want to inflict on the state of Oregon and America. None of this is just my opinion. It's hard facts. Check it out for yourself. Just some food for thought.
We're back in session. It's the Rob Taylor Report. And here he is, Rob Taylor.
Hey, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that. The wise old sage there, Jim Bice. Good to hear from him. We have a caller on the line, and I'm going to go straight to the caller. Michael, are you there?
Yes, I am. Hi.
Hi. How you doing?
Oh, I'm trying to get rid of this bug that's going around, and I've had it for like 4 days, and I'm just hibernating here.
What kind of bug is it? Is it one of those congestion bugs, or is
yeah.
it one of those? Oh, good, because I hate the diarrhea vomiting bug. You know, that's the worst. Where you sitting
now,
on it?
What do you suggest? What kind of medicine you taking?
I take a couple of shots and go to bed early.
Oh. Oh, I see.
It's better than actually. You know what I like is NyQuil, and I don't think it actually heals me, but it just knocks you out long enough so you can enjoy sleeping at night. You know
well,
what I'm saying?
Well, this stuff is in my chest. It's like I can hardly breathe. It's starting to loosen up. I've been drinking this other stuff and taking a few pills, which I don't normally do in
yeah.
my past. But anyhow, I was wondering if you could explain, I'll take the answer off the air. Why do you oppose the pool in Bandon?
Oh, I don't oppose pools, so to say. What I'm opposed to is putting any pool in public property because it becomes a liability of the city.
Okay, I'll just hang up because I'm running out of... I just listened to the answer off the phone.
All right, you got it. And anyone else who's asking, I'm not opposed to an aquatic center that's self-sufficient and is a private business on private land. And originally... Well, not originally, but after the last election, the pool pushers, and that's what I'm calling them now, they don't deserve the respect to be called anything else because they've been pushing us on us after we've already told them no several times. But they keep telling us that a couple of years ago that this was going to be a private endeavor, that they were going to raise money, and it wasn't going to have to involve the city. And this was after the vote for the recreational taxing district. And, you know, it's funny, the mayor and one of her emails exchanges between her and the people who are on the anti-pool committee, those people, she was telling them that she's ticked off because people have been putting posters around town anonymously. And she's mad because she doesn't think that people should be putting up stuff anonymously in the paper, which is ran by an editor who's a yellow journalist, as far as I'm concerned. She tries to edit everyone's opinion in their paper. When you're writing or when you're writing to the editor, a letter of the editor, it's supposed to be your opinion, and she shouldn't be putting or injecting her opinions upon those letters. And that's exactly what she's doing. I've seen it. But the mayor is upset because people are posting stuff anonymously, and yet... she doesn't have a problem with this guy who wants to give, or we don't even know if it's a guy, but this sponsor who wants to give $2.5 million to the pool committee as long as the city puts the pool in the park. And because they got this offer, the city is now bending over backwards to do whatever they can to put that pool in the park, and they shouldn't because the voters already said no. And like I said, because of the margin, not only did we say no, we said hell no. And so I don't have a problem with aquatic centers that are privately owned and they have a piece of property and they're complaining because they don't have the money to upkeep the property or develop it so that they can put a pool on it. Well, who the hell's problem is that? It's not mine. I don't want to go swimming in your damn pool, and even if the bandit had a pool. And here's what I get a little ticked off about, is that the voters have already said no. And we've already got all these other facilities in Bandon Park where they want to put this pool. We've got Sprague Theater, so basically the taxpayers are paying for the drama club. We got the library out there, so the taxpayers are paying for the book club. We got the nice community center, so we're paying for the breakfast club. So we're paying for all these clubs, and yet they just keep coming back with more and more and more. And eventually, you're going to be paying more for the upkeep of all these facilities that are luxuries. They're not something that is a necessity. These are amenities to life. They're not something that we absolutely need. And so the more and more money that we put into these other entities, the less money we're going to have to take care of the streets of Bandon. The less money we're going to have to take care of the facilities that all the people use. So a pool is a bad idea for such a small city. And if you don't believe me, go look at Coquille. They're always running in the red. Go look at North Bend. They're always running in the red. Go look at Coos Bay in the red. So why would I want a pool to be in the red in my city that I don't want to pay for when I've already answered the question twice? And that's why I'm opposed to a public pool. But if you want to build your own, go right ahead. And until next week, folks, you carry on, Coos County. Carry on.